You didn't share it, did you?
No, I wait for it to pop up.
Hmm. Well, welcome. Either way, happy Valentine's Day, everybody. Today, we're going to build logo stencils and etch onto this. Is that choppy? Can you look at that on your thing and tell me if it's coming in all choppy? Because it looks real choppy on my end. Hmm. Yeah, yeah. But we're going to build logo stencils. So the cool part about building your own stencil is that you can do a lot of really neat custom work, you know, like Happy Anniversary Elks Lodge or whatever you want to put on your blades if you're into that. I personally don't do that. I think when you start etching a whole bunch of stuff on the side of the blade, it looks cheap.
It's definitely choppy. Did you turn your Wi-Fi off?
No, I don't know what I'm working on. Should I turn my Wi-Fi off? No, Wi-Fi's on. Hmm. Hey, Dimitri. Welcome. So we're going to build stencils. I'm going to show you my homemade light box and how I do it. I know this video is coming in choppy. I'm not sure why that's happening. Probably has something to do with the weather because it's snowing again. But I'll try to move slow so we can get through it. But the night's coming along really well. We're almost done with it. And then I have to put my logo on it. And I've got some coal or hot stamps that I can stamp my logo on carbon steels when I'm heating them up. But I don't have any way to stamp cold on stainless steel. And I can't just throw this in the forge. It's just going to decarb like crazy. So I have to etch my logo when I do stainless knives. And I do that by creating my own stencils. And that's what we're going to do today, because if you are a knife maker and you want to etch logos or you want to etch custom work for your customers or something like that, there's no better way to go than making your own stencils. You can buy stencils, you can send in your proofs and they'll send you, you know, a dozen or so burned stencils. And, you know, it can cost a bit compared to the cost of the stencil material. And I'll show you what that looks like. I have... usually it'll come in an envelope like this because these are old, so they're already burned up. They're no good, so I'll just use one of them. When I get mine, I usually cut it up into smaller pieces, and this one doesn't look too bad. I could probably still use this if I wanted to, but I have a new sheet, so I'm not going to bother. This one's about 2 years old being held in there, and as it cures under light, it gets darker. You see the color difference? And the object to put some sort of a mask on here and then expose it to intense light and then you develop it. What it has is it's a very fine micro mesh screen and it's got some photosensitive emulsion on both the front and the back side. So you would take something like a stencil, and I have all kinds of different things that I use. I have a whole bunch of them. I usually print off big sheets. You can see that. There's my logo. Whatever. This one says Survival Hardware in a little rocking horse pattern. These say 1095 steel on off in case I was doing something in 1095 and I wanted to etch that in. These say Survival Hardware made in Idaho. And then they got some different knife models, Sear Vader, 5160, just various different little things like that. But you can do pictures and you can do great detail on them. This is what it is. It's just a blank sheet of this stuff, 3M inkjet paper. And all this stuff I'm showing you here, I will go through, Amazon, and I'll put links to all of this stuff on Amazon if I can find it, if it's available there. But I know a lot of this stuff is. So I print on that sheet, and then ideally you would, let me find a smaller one. you would use something like this over the sheet. And then when you hit it with intense light, this masks out the light on that one spot. So you got to print like in really high quality, and that would mask out the light. And then when you develop this piece, everything that wasn't covered by the mask cures, and where the mask is at, it's still a raw piece and it will just wash away with the developing solution. So that's the idea behind it. You can tell it's a little darker in here right now, and I'll have to kill that light too. I like to work under as little light as possible. Usually when I make my stencils, I make them at nighttime out here in the shop with barely any light on, just so I can extend the life of my stencil material. But I think we can get away with doing it one time. So what I do is my stencil material lives in this little thing here. I'm going to pull it out a little bit and just trim off a piece to make a stencil. Okay. And it lives in there. So this is my stencil material, and I don't want to expose it to any more light than I have to, so I'll keep it in the palm of my hand right now. And I'm going to show you my setup here. This is my light box, and it is nothing more than an ammo can with a hole drilled in the top. And then I have this reptile bulb, 150-watt reptile bulb inside here. And then I have some foam stacked up to get a decent little distance away from that, because if I get it too close or too far away, I have issues with burning. This is just what worked for me. And then I have two pieces of glass and one piece of white cardboard inside. This would probably be more efficient if I went ahead and spray glued it and lined it with tin foil, or even just spray painted the inside white. But for now, it works for me the way I want it to. So I need to get my stencil. And I'm going to use just my logo. I had a better one, a cleaner one. Is it there? You don't want them to be dirty, because fingerprints and stuff like that will also come through on them. Yeah, I guess that's okay. It's got a few fingerprints on it, but we'll see if they come through. I mean, it's all just a test anyway. So I'm going to put this logo right in the center of my piece of my film. And then I'm going to put it under the glass, so those two are together, and directly under the bulb. And then I'm going to cover it with that glass. I keep this door on there just to kind of keep it in the dark as much as possible, but also I can look in and look at it as it's exposing. So I'll set my timer. I have this timer here. I'm going to set this timer for 5 minutes.
Here.
Oh, hey, Grumpy Grunt, welcome. So I got my timer set for, what's that?
Those
Okay, let me get this started. Welcome, Jay Pierce. So I got my timer set for 5 minutes. I got everything lined up inside the box, and I turn the light on. Boom, lights on. Start the timer. And now we just wait. So it's gonna basically sit in there and expose. And hopefully this works. Every time you get a batch of stencil material, it's a good idea to make a couple of stencils, just small ones, and get your exposure times down. I've noticed it changes from sheet to sheet, or if you've had the sheet for a while. And then when your stencils are made, you want to keep them clean always and keep them out of the light. So I keep them in this little wooden box inside of a drawer. And then I always, always clean them immediately after use. So just in case we mess that one up, I already burned one, and I also burned a made in Idaho to put on the spine of the knife, so we can get down to etching when we're done. Because I do mess them up occasionally. And I'll show you, like, this one was made out of some old stencil material that I had. And you can see deep down in there that some of it didn't expose right. You see how that is? Every one of those has a little bit in there that I couldn't get to scrub out, so it didn't expose. Because this is an old material, that's why I replaced it with a brand new material. Here's an example of one that's underexposed. And if you underexpose it, the material doesn't wash away at all. See how it's got a shine over it? If that shines over it, I'll give you another example here. If that shines over it, let me get that shine back. The shine shouldn't penetrate the screen. See that? So if it's got that shiny film over the top of it, then it was underexposed and it won't work either. This is an example. It won't, probably won't even focus, but it just says Norseman on it. And it was overexposed. I left it for too long of an exposure time, and some of that light creeped in and cured it up underneath the masking that I used. So those are just three examples of things that can actually go wrong with the process. And then, like I said, this is an older piece, and you can see that the color is already changing because a new piece is a fairly light, almost transparent blue. And once they start darkening up, then they're basically being exposed and you can't do much with them. So now we're just waiting on the time. And what's going to happen, and I'll have to do it fairly quickly, is when the timer goes off, I'll hit the timer, turn off the light, and I'll remove the stencil that got burned. Now, each side of this stencil, each side of that has a very thin plastic film. And what I do is I take, just use a razor blade up in the corner, and I kind of pick at it until I can get that film to peel up. It's super thin, and it's got a lot of static electricity, so there's a, once you get it, you got to kind of move quick. But so I got the film off a part of it, see? Comes off a little easier after the thing's cured, but I want to get that film off of everything. And it wants to stick to you. And it's on both sides. So keep in mind, like, while I'm trying to get this film off, this photosensitive emulsion is actually being exposed to the light that's around me. So that's something you got to work quick at. And then I would take this piece and I'll put it down in the developer concentrate, and I'll scrub it with a soft bristle brush and try and get the part that was masked to wash away. And we'll see if my exposure time is right. I played with them this morning and it ended up being about a 5-minute exposure was right. The last time I used my material on this setup, 8-minute exposure was what was correct. So my exposure times have actually changed slightly because of the different batch of material or the age of it or whatever. So it's not a bad idea when you get a new batch of the film, and it doesn't come small. It comes in like a big sheet, like a 4x4 or something. And what was that?
Michael Sheffer said, "Hi, Dave. Grumpy Grunt said, well, stop talking and get it in there."
It is in there. I'm waiting for the exposure. See? So there's my 5-minute timer. I'll turn it off. And now we have to develop it.
I said I paid $72 for two different stencil designs. I got 5 stencils on each sheet. They're industrial strength stencils. I wanted to learn this type so I can make one off stencil. So you can make one off.
Yeah, that's the real beauty to this, is one off stencils. You can do whatever you want with them. So now I've peeled. That's about where I'm at right now. And you can see it's still shiny. Now I have to put it in my developer solution. And I usually clip the corner with a hemostat. And then I can develop it like this. I'll move around the developer a little bit, and then I'll let it sit there for a second so it can kind of break down the inside of that stencil. The top of the workbench here is actually the belt from a treadmill, you know, the running belt. So it's got these little micro spaces in it, which are really nice. So when I'm ready to start scrubbing, I lay this down on that and I can scrub away and it doesn't make a big mess all over my bench. But it does take a bit of work to scrub it. And remember that emulsion is on both sides. So you have to clean both sides really well. And then I've noticed a lot of times that you can, if you put it up over your finger like this, you can get down into the tiny, tiny areas a little bit better. It's a process, it takes some time. But you'll actually feel under the brush, you'll feel it kind of starting to catch and drag when that outer emulsion starts coming off. So it's kind of time consuming. There's really no limits to the amount of detail that you can put into it. And once it's done and developed, it's not all that light sensitive. You could leave them laying out on your bench for a while and you're not going to damage them. But what I've noticed is if I don't take care of them and keep them in a dark place, what happens over time is the emulsion kind of hardens and it will eventually crack. And those cracks will allow your etching solution to flow through it. And then you'll have your stencil, but you'll have all these little cracks coming out of it, which looks really amateur on your knife blades. So that's the point where you want to make new stencils. I got to hold it up to the light a little bit and look through it and see where it's still at and where it's not. And this is one of those things where the dimensions of your light box, the amount of light that your lamp puts out, distance from the light, the hardness of your stencil, the age of your material, it all varies greatly. So I can't give you like a solid time. The times I use 5-minute exposure and then scrub it clean is a good place to start. But keep your little notebook with you and keep track of what it takes under your conditions of your lamp and your setup. And then base it on that. And then anytime you need to make a stencil, make one or two, get your magic recipe for that day in those conditions, and then test it out and see what you come up with. And if it works, then make your batch of stencils or your special stencils or whatever you have to do. So, okay, I think I'm pretty much developed now. You can see developed. So what I'm going to do now is I'll rinse it real good in clean water. All right, so I'm rinsing it in clean water, and then I'm going to etch it onto a piece of scrap of something just to see if everything comes out clean, because I may not be able to see a little bit that didn't come out. It may look a little weird in there. I may not be able to see that, but it'll definitely show up when I etch it if there's an issue. Okay, so I rinsed it in water really good. I'm gonna dry it out. Dry it out with a rag. All right, and now there's my stencil complete. And I'm gonna etch it onto a piece of scrap. So let's do the etching process, shall we? What do I have? This is my knife. I'll put my logo on that. It's a Gerber, but whatever. So when you're working on a knife blade, if you want it really, really in the right spot, the best thing to do is tape it on. And I have rolls of electrical tape here, and that's what I use it for, is to tape my logos on, but I don't usually tape when I'm getting ready to test. So let's test. And then after we do this little quick test, then I'll show you what my etching system looks like. For starters, this is my positive lead. You just got to clamp it on the metal somewhere. And then this is the etching lead. And what I use for mine is you're supposed to use like this felt stuff or whatever, but I usually just cut a piece of t-shirt and roll it up about 3 times and then fold it over the piece. And I found it works really good. In fact, sometimes it works better than the foam or the felt pieces. And then my etching solution, I keep in this little squeeze bottle, and you have to make sure you have the right etching solution for the type of steel that you're working with. This one happens to be good for stainless and carbon, but not all of them are. So I want to wet that pad down pretty good. I'm going to hold, in this case, I'm just going to hold my stencil where I want it. I put my etcher usually at about 4 and put it in the etching. I'll show you that in a minute. I put it in the etching mode and then let it work. And I work off of I can feel a slight vibration going on right now in the etcher. It's like a really high speed vibration. So I can feel that vibration. You see how it's etching, it's removing that material and putting it on here. It's because that, it may not work as well on this, thinking about it, because this is a Gerber, and it's probably, coated somehow, like electroplated. And if it's electroplated, that means there's a layer of copper in there, which this etchant might not etch copper correctly. So I might have to go to something else. But.
Dimitri said, thanks for sharing this.
Yeah, man. No problem, Dimitri. So yeah, what happened is it etches down so far and then it doesn't want to etch through like the copper and stuff. So it's hard to etch on something that's been electroplated. I probably should have thought about that before I went into it, but I can still feel it vibrating a little bit. And then I'm going to kick my etcher down in the mark phase because mine has 2 settings. It has etch or mark, and etch will cut it in and mark will leave it black. So I'll put it on the mark setting. You got to kind of develop your own habit for times and materials. Okay, so we should have got something. Without any cleanup on it, this is what we ended up with. You can see I've played with it a few times. But so that's what we ended up with on that. And if it was on a knife, I would probably check the degree of etch on it by buffing it with a light sandpaper, because if I buff it and all the black comes off, then it didn't etch, it only marked. But now it's buffed and I have my mark in there. So that's that. And these stencils will work either way. So if you have something like my mark here, you really want to pay attention to make sure that you got it laid on there correctly, because it's easy to etch it backwards or the wrong way. So that's good. So we're going to take that and we're going to do that. So let's prep it out and do it. But I want to show you first my etcher, which is this. I have this Personalizer Plus is what it's called. And it's in the off position now, but I'll end up turning it on. And when I etch somewhere past 4 to 4.5. Or on the etch, 4 to 4.5, and then I'll crank it down just under 3, and that's where I mark it. But you're gonna have to play with yours and your setup and decide what works best for you. So I can turn some light on here now because we're not dealing with emulsion.
Perfect Grant said, nice, cool how that works, and asked if it was a binding room.
It is a bind rune. It's a copy of, it's a mix of Parathro and Lagus, and it means luck in life. That my maker's mark is luck in life. So I'm going to kick a light on here so we can actually see what we're doing. And then I want to, because I just used that stencil, I'm now cleaning it in fresh water. Because what it's doing when you do the etch part is it's actually sending electrolysis down through the metal, and it's removing metal and pulling it up. And that metal is being deposited into your cloth here. The cloth is not only holds the etching solution, but it's also a place to deposit all that stuff it pulls out of the metal. So in doing that, that means it leaves residue in the screen. So you always want to clean the screen when that residue is fresh, because if you just throw it aside dirty and then come back to it and try and clean it the next time you use it, you may not get it all out, and because it dries on real hard. And yeah, it would not be good. So let me dry my screen. It's really not that complicated. I'm probably making it sound more complicated than it is. You get the stuff and you practice with it a little bit and get to where you want to be, and then you just make it happen. So I'm going to tape this on where I want it. Use a little bit of tape here. I had a started roll. I already had a roll out here. It was started. Yeah, whatever. Now, I will caution, don't, when you're making your screens, the temptation is, like, I know that looks like a whole lot of a waste of material to have such a big piece. I want that material to always be bigger than this, because if this is off the edge and it's touching the metal, it'll etch a line into the steel. You always want that to stay in contact with the screen at all times. So I wouldn't cut any, no matter what you're doing, any smaller than what I have here. And if you're doing something bigger, make sure you give yourself enough room that you can hit all the areas of the etch without ever reaching off of the screen, because it will etch your blade. So I'm gonna find my good spot here and tape it on. And I use electrical tape because it's waterproof. That looks like a pretty good spot for me, just inside of the plunge. I want to make sure that it's inside the plunge all the way. Looks like it's good. Looks like it's straight and centered. And the reason I tape these on when I'm doing it on a knife, because I can, if I'm not sure that it's working right, like just a second ago on that little pocket knife, is that I can peel it back and I can see how it's looking, and then I can put it back down and it ends up in the exact same spot. If I don't tape it down, I can't do that. Once I remove it, I'll never get it back in the same spot again. So, all right. So this knife is close to done, and now we're getting ready to burn our logo into it. And the object at this point is to be successful and not snatch defeat out of the jaws of victory, because that's what could easily happen by screwing this up. So I want to make sure my probe is clamped on somewhere where it can hold on good and tight. And then this is actually a chunk of carbon, like a pencil lead, like a big square chunk of pencil lead with that stuff on it. And this is the scary part. You don't want the sopping wet, because if it's sopping wet when you squish it down in there, that stuff, the electrolysis material, will run underneath your screen and etch little lines under the blade. So it needs to be damp, but not like drippy. So if it's dripping, it's got way too much on it. So I'm going to crank it up to just past 4 on the etch mode. And then here we go. And I can hear the tone change. I can feel the buzz in my hand, like the whole thing's vibrating a little, and I could hear the tone change in the machine. And I never really want to etch like super deep. It's not going to go, you know, a 16th of an inch in. It would blow out before it gets that far in. I just want to go far enough in to where I can put it in the mark mode and mark the bottom and leave the bottom of it nice and black so I can sand lightly over the top and it'll clean everything up real neat. It may all sound like grease, but you'll see in a minute. Okay, so that's probably etched in good enough, but just to be sure, I'm going to take a quick peek at it. Oh yeah, that looks really good. And now I'm going to put it in mark mode. Crank it down to about just under 3. Make sure that stays on. And you can see where it transferred all that metal. So I'm going to go to the other side for the mark. Nothing. Like I just, because I'm holding the knife blade, I touch it with my finger. When I touch this wet, I can feel this right now. It's like a little electric shock. Kind of like the sensation of putting your tongue on a 9-volt battery. Because I'm basically completing the circuit. So before I'm done with it, I want to peel this back before I remove the tape and just see what I have. It looks like I have a really good mark. But you can see that there's some solution on there. So I'm happy with that mark, but I want to get that solution cleaned off really fast so it doesn't discolor the blade. So I'll get that out of there really quick with just clean water. All right, and there we go. We just not only made that stencil, but we etched it onto a knife nice and clean. So how was that? So that didn't take too long. I mean, it took me a little longer than it probably should have, but that's with me sitting here running my mouth too. And now I'm gonna go, I haven't done this one in a long time, but I made another one today and it says, made in Idaho, USA. So I'm going to put that on the spine because the spine's still shiny and I'm going to end up buffing that out to a 600 grit anyway. So I'm going to go ahead and put on a good old fashioned made in Idaho. And I have to make sure that I really, really take my time to center it. My pleasure, Michael. Thanks for watching.
Philly 52 said, wow, that's pretty neat. I never saw that done before.
There's one. And there's always a chance I could mess this up. Like, I'm trying to look through the stencil material right now to make sure I get everything lined up nice and straight. I think that front one needs a little adjustment. Yeah, not too much. All right, I'm pretty happy with that. It looks like it lines up pretty easy, pretty centered on the spine. So nothing to do but mess up, right? So let's do this. So now I'm going back to, I'll clamp that on. I will add a little more etching stuff because I lost a little. I'm going back to the etch at 4.5 and see what we get. This one I have to just trust the stencil or the etcher because I can't take it off and peek at it. But since it just worked with these settings, it should work no problem. Now, when I'm doing the etch part, initially the screen looked all white, but now it's starting to look really gray. That's usually deep enough when it gets gray like that. And then I can probably give it a little bit more after that just for good measure.
Camera's awful blurry, I think.
And see how it's transferring right there. So now the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to slip it over to mark, roll it down to just under 3, and I'm going to hold it there on the mark for a minute. Hopefully this turns out pretty amazing. We'll see.
Michael asked, will this process only work on metal since it's electrolysis, or can you do this on stone material?
Yeah, I don't think you could do it on stone unless that stone was somehow metal conductive. I think the process is just for metal. I think stone, they use more acid material. Which you might be able to use the same screens for stone. I just don't know. I don't deal with it.
Quinn Warman popped in. He said, just saw you on, but he damaged off to Kakurua to go for bike riding, help with PTSD. To watch your full video tonight. And then having a go at his first night soon.
Cool. All right. Let's see what we got. So there you can see. Made in Idaho, USA. Clean my camera thingy.
Yeah, your camera lens. I think that's what's wrong. It's probably the thumbprint.
Is that any better? Well, I just cleaned the material off too, so. Yeah. Where's my rag at?
It doesn't look so washed out, the whole thing.
Right. So there's the spine. And it looks backwards on my camera. I don't know how it looks for you. Okay.
Yeah.
On my camera, it looks backwards right now, which just freaked me out. And I had to make sure I pointed it in the right way. But so that says made in Idaho. And then there's my stencil on the side. And we're good. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take just a little strip of 600 grit sandpaper. And I'm going to buff on this spot right here that I etched.
Deeper smash, it looks great. Grumpy Brent said, I don't care what anybody says, it's cool as shit.
Yeah, so now I'm just gonna glide over it. Because remember, I high glossed the spine and I didn't want to keep a high gloss. I want a 600 grit. And I'll go through it in a little while and lay down the grains, but I just want to show you why I etch it and then mark it instead of just marking it. I just want to show what it looks like after you buff it out. So there's that. And look how clean that is, if I can get some light on it. I'm sorry, guys, this is kind of tough, but there we go. And that's all there is to it. So what do you guys think of that process? That's pretty cool, huh? To just be able to do things like that and like that. It really does kind of up the game. And you can, you know, if somebody wants one for their son, you know, happy 21st birthday or congratulations on graduating Marine Corps boot camp, whatever they want, it's so easy to just do it. You could do one like this and I could put United States Marine Corps across the spine for somebody and anything. Like I wouldn't decorate it. I wouldn't put like a firework pattern or anything weird on it. But if somebody really wanted something meaningful on there, that's a really good way to do it right there. So so what do you think? You guys got any questions about that process? Did I skip over something you might have maybe wanted a little more information on?
Michael said it looks great.
Thanks, Michael.
J. Pierce Max said, I really like this.
Yeah, it's really nice, J. Pierce. I know that you buy the stencils, and those are definitely a higher quality than what I'm making here. But when you're doing a one-off or you just need something quick or something really unique, this is most definitely a cool skill to have or a cool ability to have in your shop, even if you don't use it all the time. Will any UV light work? I don't know. Like I said, I got mine. It has to be UV in order to cure the emulsion. But I got mine, I think when I bought mine, when I first did my research, it said 150 watts was recommended, or maybe it said something like over 75 watts. And this is what I found was 150 watts at the pet store for reptile cages. And it was pretty cheap. I think it was like 12 bucks for the bulb. And then this here, this piece on top was one of them chicken lanterns with the big metal dome. I just disassembled it, pulled the metal dome out, put it back together inside of an ammo can. It's super easy. Yeah. What else? Any more questions on that? It was, you know, it's a pretty simple process. It gets kind of intuitive after you've done it a few times, but it also ups your game too. Like if somebody wants, you know, Love You Pops or, you know, Dale Earnhardt Jr. or whatever on the side of their blade, you can charge well for that. That's worth it. I wouldn't even make the stencil and put something special on it like that for anything less than a $30 upcharge. And you just seen what it took to do it. But I would not do it for less than a $30 upcharge because of the materials and the time to go into it. And the value that it would have to the customer. I just think that's a fair way to do it. And potentially even more depending on what we were working on. So.
Michael Schiffer said, I was looking a couple days ago for your knives that you have for sale, but couldn't find them. What website do you sell on?
I only sell on my website, survivalhardwarellc.com. And the only knives I have up there right now are two folding knives, two double-bladed slip joints, a Barlow, I think, and a Swayback. That's all I have up there right now. Most of my knives, especially my fixed blade knives, are gone. Like this one was sold before I even had it heat treated. My fixed blade knives just go too fast. I'll never probably end up getting too many fixed blades up on the website. If you see one on there, it's a fluke.
It appears nice that my wife does gel fingernails and has UV lights to cure the nails.
Yep, that'll do it. That'll do it for sure.
Grumpy Grunt said the web address is in the description of the video, but it won't let him post it.
Won't let him post what?
Your web address, I guess the comments for Michael.
Oh, yeah. You can't post web links in my comments. I've got them disabled because I was getting a lot of weird spam stuff to weird places that I don't necessarily give a thumbs up to. So only people that can post a link is me and my wife. But there is a link to my website right in the description that's underneath there. If you scroll down, it'll have a link to my YouTube, or not my YouTube, but my Facebook, my Instagram, Twitter, my website, my blog probably. So anywhere that I'm at now on the blogosphere, there's a link down there that can get to me, including my email.
Grumpy Grunt, it's smart move, but the link's in the description.
Yeah, man, I got some weird shit before, so yeah, nothing can post in my comments. Sorry about that, guys.
Jay Chris Nice would like to know if you're going to do another live build.
Yeah, probably. Maybe a folding knife. Maybe, I don't know. Sure, eventually. I want to, you know, when I hit 10,000 followers, it's arbitrary because it doesn't really make me any money, but when I hit 10,000 followers, I'm going to do another knife build and give it away. The live knife build's a little bit of a struggle because I can only work on the knife for max 1 hour, three times a week. And it's very frustrating to have this knife. So you know how bad I wanted to just jump in here and finish the damn thing and be done with it. But so it's real frustrating. So it's hard to do a live knife build like this, unless we just kick it down and do like two 24-hour sessions and get the whole thing done at one time, which would be a pain in the ass.
But it'd be a lot of beer.
It'd be a lot of beer. Yeah, I'd be pretty hammered. But
Michael said, okay, that's where I was looking. I'll contact you about an order.
Cool. I don't do custom. I don't take custom orders anymore. Contact me. We'll talk about it. But I don't generally do custom orders anymore. I just make what I can when I can, because it's just a hobby, and it actually started turning into work. And then I ended up getting backed up so far, and I had so many people waiting on their knives, and I didn't have time to make them because I was out doing other things like fishing and four wheeling. And
you stressed the fuck out.
And I was stressed the hell out over it because I was like, oh, these people are waiting on their knives. And so I just quit doing custom knives, and I just do whatever I have the time to do, whenever I want to do it, and I post it up for sale, and usually it's gone like that. So probably not the best business model, but I've never really cared much about that. So
totally understands.
Yeah. And yeah, I don't know. It's just fun. It's my hobby. It's my stress reliever. It really shouldn't be a cause for stress for me, but that's where we're at right now. Now, all I have left to do is I'm going to have to, you know, I'm going to do some final drags on the blade, like we've already done, just to clean it up around the logo. No big deal. Just a couple of quick passes with the 600 grit. I'm going to run 600 grit all the way around the spine and the edge. And then I'll do, now that everything's done, I'll do a little more burnishing on the handle and build a leather sheath for it. Probably next time. Today's Friday, right?
Is it sharp?
No. Probably next time. I think today's Friday, so Monday, right?
Monday is President's Day.
Monday is Trump Day. So I'll come back here on Monday. I'll have the rest of that stuff probably done. But I'll go through and I'll show you how I sharpen them. We'll sharpen it up real quick. And then that's going to be it for this knife. We're probably not going to do a leather sheath live or nothing. That would be a pain in the ass. This was hard enough. So, but yeah, Monday we'll sharpen this baby up. I'll show you the little fine refinements I did with sanding the edges and stuff. And hopefully I have a better connection, because this one still looks real choppy to me. And I'm not sure what that's about. But hopefully I'll have a better connection. We'll be back here then, and we will knock it out of the park. So that's what I got for you guys. What I'm going to do now is, when I end this, I'm going to go upstairs and I'm going to jump on my computer and I'm going to edit the description and everything, because I think this is like the same description just naturally pops up as when we go live on Sundays. So I got to wipe that out, put on the description for this show, and then I'll go through and I'll add the emulsion film, at least the emulsion film, the bulb, the transparency stuff that I use, and if I can find it, the electrolyte solution and the developer solution. So if I can find all those things on Amazon, I'll put links underneath here. Give me about an hour to have that done, and then that'll be there. You can follow those links. You can get most of the weird stuff that I've used for this whole build has been posted underneath the videos. And so if you need to get to them, the glues and the solvents and all that kind of stuff. So if you need that stuff, it's all listed there for you. But we're pushing 48 minutes, which is getting real close to my limit. So I'm going to have to bail on you. I'm going to put links right here and right here to the rest of this series, the other 12 videos or 11 or whatever. And then right here, I'll put the folding knife build that I did. And other than that, that's all I got for you. I answered your questions. Hopefully I answered them all. If not, email me or hit it down in the comments, and I'll get to them. So thanks for popping in, guys. I will see you guys on Monday.